Secession. Now, joining the Union is specifically addressed. Seceding from the Union is not addressed. So, if the Constitution doesn't address secession, and the only thing that the premise that Lincoln used, which is the perpetual union, exists only in the Articles of Confederation, which recognized the sovereignty of the states, what did they think? Sit yourself down in their seats. So now it's 1787. You've had the Articles of Confederation, and you've concluded a war of about 8 years. And you spent massive amounts of blood and treasure freeing yourself from the government that you and your fathers and your grandfathers had trusted to defend your liberty, because it had become, as in your perception anyway, dangerous to your liberty. Would you have ever organized yourself under a government from which you could not lawfully withdraw if you found that government to be dangerous to your liberty? Is that a rational position? So when you're looking at these documents, you have to really sit down and think about what was going through their heads when they wrote it. Now, New Hampshire has a very proud constitutional history. You have to go back to the founding period. We had the first battle of the War for Independence, the first time that the British actually suffered a defeat, in December of 1774. Battle of Fort William and Mary. That was the first time that Paul Revere took to his horse. It was 4 months before Lexington and Concord. The king had determined that, you know, there was a mood for rebellion in the air, and so he had forbade further importation of arms to the colonies. The people of New Hampshire just paid a heavy tax to fortify Fort William and Mary, now Fort Constitution, out in Newcastle at the mouth of Portsmouth Harbor. And so General Gage decided that he was going to send, that fort was garrisoned with 11 men. And so the rumor was that Gage was going to send a company of men up to reinforce the garrison. And Paul Revere, on December 13th, rode up to New Hampshire and apprised the Portsmouth Patriots of General Gage's intent. And John Langdon, who later became Speaker of the House, was a president of New Hampshire under our second constitution, and then later became our first U.S. Senator, first president of the Federal Senate, and then came back and was a state senator again and a governor again. General John Sullivan, who became a general in the War for Independence and spent some time as the chief executive of New Hampshire, and Thomas Pickering, organized the Patriots of Portsmouth. And 400 men marched upon the fort with farm implements and a few muskets. And the men inside fired over their heads, and it then fell to hand-to-hand combat. They subdued the soldiers. A little blood was spilled, but only, you know, bloody noses and that kind of thing. And they surrendered the fort. They lowered the British ensign. And that was the first British defeat. And the Patriots took all the shot and powder. That was on December 14th. They took all the shot and powder. And then they thought better of their actions. They went back on December 15th and took all the small cannon as well. And those are the arms that are suspected that the British were marching on Lexington and Concord to recover. They are the arms that then Colonel Stark used to relieve the Patriots in the Battle of Bunker Hill. So that's December of 1775. We get into the summer, hot summer of December of 1774. We get into the hot summer of 1775. And the people of Portsmouth, now this is another little aside. Everybody thinks of the colonial militias as rushing to General Washington's aid and participating in the War for Independence. Well, they actually split about 50-50. Some of them stayed with the king, some of them went with the colonists, Because they now had conflicting duties. They swore an oath to the king, but their oath was to protect the colonists. So what do you do? Everybody had to make a decision. Roger's Rangers fought, the Queen's Rangers fought for the British. Well, our governor at the time, his name escapes me at the moment, I should know it, Wentworth, Bennington Wentworth, was harboring a loyalist militia officer in his house. And the people of Portsmouth rolled a cannon up to his front door to persuade him to turn the militia officer over to them. Never recorded whether he did or not. But he then decided it wasn't really where he wanted to stay. He immediately retreated to Fort William and Mary, and in September, he quit the state. And the state began to fall, especially in the outer portions, into relative anarchy. And all of a sudden, in December, the elected legislature had kind of a ye gods moment. They said, we don't have a government. And they sat down, they went into session on December 21st, which means they worked through Christmas, because they didn't really celebrate Christmas at that time. And on January 6, 1776, they presented a constitution for the state of New Hampshire to the people. They phrased it as a temporary constitution. And that constitution had one purpose, to protect the lives and the properties of the good people of the colony from the wicked designs of evil men. To paraphrase, to provide justice, because there were no courts open to punish evildoers. That's precisely the way they phrased it. So when we go up to Concord, we have one reason to be there, to provide justice. That Constitution saw us well into the war. In the Constitution, they imagine, or they anticipate a peaceful conclusion to this unhappy and unnatural conflict. No such conclusion was obviously forthcoming. So in December of 1775, now that legislature had created a constitution. The constitutions created in 1776, because that's what all the other colonies also created constitutions, were created by their state legislatures. John Langdon saw a defect in this. Because if government is by consent, who has the authority to create the government? The people. And so, in 1779, he organized the first constitutional convention in the history of the world. An important concept, because now you have a different body creating the rules for making the laws than the one that's going to be making the laws. Ours was in July, Massachusetts had theirs in September. It was pretty much identical to the form of, I think the Bill of Rights had seven articles. It was the form of government that we had had throughout the war, the same form of government that most of the colonies had, and it was the form of government that was exercised under the Articles of Confederation, where really all you had was a legislature. You had a House of Representatives, which elected an executive council, which serves as the upper body of the upper house of the legislature. And the president of the executive council was the president of the state. And throughout most of the war years, he was also the chief justice of the courts. Congress had pretty much the same thing. You had the Congress, the president of the Congress was the chief executive of the United States. And under the Articles of Confederation, they had a Supreme Court of three legislators elected by the Congress. When the legislature was out of session, they elected a committee to function as the executive, along with the president. In the states, those were called committees of safety. You've probably heard that phrase before. We now have a movement out there, people want, we're gonna go create a committee of safety and organize a militia. What they don't realize is the committee of safety was a subcommittee of the legislature. Much like we have the fiscal committee now that takes care of our fiscal matters when the legislature's out of session. The people looked at that form of government, they said no. There's too much concentration of power. And in 1780, they rejected that form of government. They rejected the Constitution, it didn't pass. 1781, there's another constitutional convention. This time, they come up with a Bill of Rights, pretty much what we have now, absence of subsequent amendments, and a form of government that is pretty much like we have now. And the people looked at that and they said, that's way too liberal, and they rejected it. 1783 comes along, and they prepared a government that was halfway in between. You had the House and the Senate. The Executive Council was three representatives and two senators elected by the legislature in joint session. And the president was elected by the people, but he served as president of the Senate and was a voting senator. So you didn't have the separation of powers that you have now. The people accepted that in 1784. Now, the other thing that's important about this, not only did we have the first constitutional convention in the history of the world, the first constitution, first state created by a written constitution without a king in 76, but we are the only jurisdiction that I know of to have ever rejected a proposed constitution, and we did it twice. So we have a really proud constitutional history. This is the Bill of Rights and the form of government that the people crafted to control their government. And that's why it's so important for those of us in government to know what the silly thing says. We had a person attend the class last week who said, well, this just sounds like it's an antiquated document to me. I said, fine, amend it. But you can't just ignore it. You can't just pretend it doesn't exist or something's inconvenient and bypass it. Otherwise, there's no rules. The Constitution for our state is very important in it gives two very important instructions, not at the beginning actually, toward the end. The first very important instruction is part two, fishing for my glasses because I can't see without them. I can't read without them anyway. At least not the fine print. First one is part two, article 37. And I'm gonna back up again. Very important concept here. When you look at this document, you'll see a whole bunch of titles on the articles. And you'll see numbers in the second, not only titles, but also numbers in part two of the form of government. For the most part, the numbers in part two and the titles throughout do not exist. So do not let the title confine how you interpret the article. The titles and the numbers in part two were inserted by an editor in 1841. Every time we publish a new set of laws, they have one of the requirements is to put the Constitution at the front. And he thought that titles and numbers in part two would be really cool. And so he put them in. There are no official titles until the 1950s when they started to be included on the ballot when amending articles. So when you see an article, particularly when you see something that says Article 37, Separation of Powers, June 2nd, 1784, it's never been amended. It has no title. So there's a lot more there than just separation of powers. In fact, there's kind of a non-separation of powers. James Madison, when writing the Federalist Papers, and Federalist Paper 47, discussing the separation of powers, said, we were the only state that got it right. Because all the other states prescribe an absolute separation of powers, and we don't. We say, in the government of this state, the three essential powers thereof, to wit, the legislative, executive, and judicial, and this is important, you'll always see the three powers of government listed in that order. And when you understand the theory behind our government, that is immensely important. Legislature, they're listed in that order because that is the power that they have. I'll show you that later in the class. But Legislative and executive judicial. Could I have some chicken fingers and onion rings?
Sure.
Thank you. Ought to be kept as separate from and independent of each other as the nature of free government will admit. Which means they can't be completely separate because they have to be watchdogs on each other. Or is consistent with that chain of connection that binds the whole fabric of the Constitution in one indissoluble bond of unity and amity, which is very important. It means every article must agree with every other article that touches on the subjects. One inseparable fabric. What happens if you have a fabric, a knit sweater, and you cut one thread and you pull it out? The whole thing unravels. So when you're looking at, when you're reading the Constitution, looking at the Constitution, seeking to understand it, you have to look at every article that has bearing on that subject. Now, there's also something else here, the word ought. In my undergraduate studies, I'm an engineer by trade, by education. My undergraduate, I did a minor in philosophy. 5 classes and a thesis. And out of those 5 classes and thesis, I came out with one parcel of knowledge that has served me throughout, and it became extremely relevant when I started looking at the constitutions. The word ought. In philosophy, I learned ought is the moral imperative. It's not should, it's not you ought, it's not. It's a good thing to do. It is duty. It is that which must be done because it is the right thing to do. Will, should, ought. It is the highest directive. So when you see the word ought in the Constitution, that it, you have to pay the highest attention to it relative to everything else you see. So they ought to be kept as separate from each other, separate from and independent of each other, as the nature of free government will admit. We want to keep them separate, but we know that we can't keep them entirely separate because they'll run away from each other. Somebody's going to seek power and abuse it. The second one that is extremely important is Article 38. Originally it was the last article in our Bill of Rights. I like to think of it as a capstone. It contains a voter's guide. Now, lawyers like to make you think that only lawyers can read the Constitution. Remember that this Constitution was sent to the people for ratification. It was expected they could read it, understand it, and knew whether it was adequate, and they judged twice that it was not adequate. And the first, in Article 38, a frequent recurrence. Now, to recur means to read, study, and discuss. That's the other thing that's important. Have a good 1780s dictionary at your disposal. I have one on my computer. I can, with a little help, I can get you so you can have one of your own on your computer. A frequent recurrence of the fundamental principles of the Constitution. And a constant adherence to, first, justice, remember our first purpose, justice, moderation, temperance, industry, and frugality, and all the social virtues, is a good idea. No. It is indispensably necessary to the preservation of the blessings of liberty and good government. The people ought, this is the voter's guide, the people ought, moral imperative, therefore, to have a particular regard to all those principles in the selection of their officers and representatives. When they're going to the polls, they want to make sure that the person they're voting for knows the Constitution and knows the restraints upon them. Flip too many pages. There we go. And they, the people, have a right to require of their officer, of their lawgivers, that's us, hopefully all of you, lawgivers and magistrates, and that includes the judges, an exact and constant observance of them in the formation and execution of the laws necessary for the good administration of government. We are not the government. The people are the government. We're the administrators of the government. We're the hirelings. We're there to do the people's will. So, when you're running for election, you want to demonstrate to the people that you know the restraints that they have put upon you in the execution of your office. And the restraints are not identical for all offices. So now, where are we? The first 10 articles of our Constitution really set the framework for everything else that comes afterward. And actually, Article 1 is probably the most magnificent piece of writing I've ever seen. The whole spirit, the whole intent of the Constitution is wrapped up in Article 1. The entire Constitution that follows is really an expository on Article 1. I spent the winter of 14 and 15 reading Locke's Second Treatise on Government. I didn't see it all really at first. All of a sudden, about a year ago, June, July of that year, I looked at Article 1 and I said, oh my God. It is the quintessential summation of Locke's ends of government. That's not the cessation, that's the ends, the purpose of government. All men are born equally free and independent. Therefore, all government of right, all legitimate government, originates in the people, is founded in consent, and instituted for the common good. When you read chapter 9, Locke tells us that everybody is born equally free into their state of nature, however perfect or imperfect that state of nature may be. We are born, to the degree that we can actually achieve a state of nature, we are born equally free and independent. Because we are born equally free and independent, no one can be put under the government of another except by his own consent. No one has a right to govern over other people. In that state of nature, we all have complete legislative, executive, and judicial authority. We're living relatively alone in the woods. Somebody comes along and assaults a member of our family. Our law is, you don't assault a member of my family. We have complete power to go apprehend the individual and execute judgment upon them, if we live in a perfect state of nature. In fact, we have the power to do the same for our neighbor if they want us to. So Locke says, why would you ever leave that state of nature if you have complete executive, legislative, executive, and judicial authority? Well, because first of all, you and the guy living however close he lives to you may not have really the same laws in mind. You don't agree on what the law is. And if he breaks your law, he may not think he broke your law, but if he breaks your law and you go over and apprehend him, you know what? He's likely to resist. He might even do violence upon you in his effort to not be subject to your law. And it's for this reason that we enter into a state of society, so that we create, we delegate our legislative, executive, and judicial powers to a government that has a legislature of our choosing, representatives whom we choose, and make laws to which we agree. And if we don't, we kick the bums out and we elect different legislators. We agree that we are going to be subject to, you know, if we break the law, that the executive authority does indeed have power to apprehend us, and we will be subject to whatever the judgment is. Knowing this, and this is Locke's words, no rational creature would consent to being, here I'm going to paraphrase, but no rational creature would consent to being in a lesser state than he had in his state of nature. Therefore, the legislative power can exist no further than the general good. That defines the general good. When we are making laws up in the legislature, the fundamental stricture upon us is that our laws must leave each and every member of the community in no worse state than if there were no law and no government. That's a pretty high bar. And I don't think we adhere to it very well at all. But that is what Article 1 says. You know, we all ponder what general welfare means in the federal constitution. And our constitution is phrased as common good and common benefit in Article 10. But it actually has a definition. Legislative power can extend no further than the general good, which means that no person would submit to being reduced to less than their state of nature. It has a definition. It's not an abstract thought. And then we have all the other, excuse me. The other 38 articles of that Constitution go on to just describe what that, all the other strictures that implies. It also pulls in, if you want to be more general about it, the whole body of Locke. That one article says, this is a Lockean social contract. It is a perfect paraphrase of Locke's purpose for government. So if you ever wanted to seek further on some vagary in our Constitution, go read Locke. I found some fascinating things out there that are just really astounding. So, Article 2. Natural rights. All men have certain natural, essential, and inherent rights, among which are enjoying and defending life and liberty, and acquiring, possessing, and protecting property. And in a word, of seeking and obtaining happiness. That's where it originally ended. That was Article 2 in its totality. In 1974, we amended that to say, equality of rights under the law should not be abridged or denied by this state on account of race, creed, color, I'm not sure how that's different than race, but race, creed, color, sex, or national origin. Probably one of the worst amendments, is one of the two worst amendments to our state constitution. We saw this last term. Second session last term, we had a bill which wanted to add, oh, I can't remember the precise wording, but basically sexual orientation to that list. The flaw in that list is natural rights are natural rights. They shouldn't be abridged on account of anything. There should have been a period after state. I mean, if I rob Representative Bates' house, David's house, does it matter what color my eyes are? Doesn't matter how much hair either of us have on our heads. No. So there should be no cause for abridging natural rights. Unfortunately, the way that's phrased, there are only five sequiturs for which you cannot abridge natural rights. Everything else is fair game. So here, eye color is fair game for abridging somebody's natural rights. Unless, of course, you connect it to race, but, you know. Also implicit in that, now this was separated out and made explicit in 1984, but implicit in that, how are you going to defend life and protect property? With arms, right? So implicit in that is the right to keep and bear arms. Pennsylvania had that stated explicitly in 1776, much the way we do now. But it's implicit in our Constitution. In 1984, Crow Dickinson, was Crow still in when you joined the legislature, David? Crow Dickinson, about so tall. I served with him a couple terms, anyway. He observed how the state and federal governments were beginning to encroach upon the right to keep and bear arms. And he believed that it should be made explicit in our Constitution. And as a result of our last constitutional convention in 1983, he got that put on the ballot and people adopted it. So now we have all persons have the right to keep and bear arms in defense of themselves, their families, their property, and the state. Does that sound pretty much like a natural right? Power to, within your tutelage, have executive, legislative, executive, and judicial authority. The next article is really interesting. It is, I guess you call it a circuit breaker clause. When men enter into a state of society, they surrender up some of their natural rights to that society in order to ensure the protection of others. Without such an equivalent, the surrender is void. So, for instance, under common law, your privacy rights are extensive. They are complete. But you surrender up a certain measure of your privacy in that if you are suspected of having committed a crime, a warrant can be drawn up to search your property and, if necessary, to arrest you. So you have voluntarily surrendered a certain amount of your privacy so that, in turn, the state can protect broaches of your property or your person. If the state categorically fails, and this isn't just like an occasional something doesn't get prosecuted, but if the state should summarily fail to protect life and property through the exercise of police power, then your surrender of your privacy is void. If we don't do our job, the deal's off. But then look at the next article, and this is often abused. Among natural rights, some are by their very nature unalienable, because no equivalent can be given or received. Given or received for them. Of this kind are rights of conscience. The state has no power to infringe upon your conscience. Think about what that means. And we kind of do it regularly. The state has no power to require you to surrender your religious morals to the state. There's an issue we've been wrestling with for a few terms now, the issue of vaccines. Now, there are a lot of theories as to why there are problems with vaccines. However, a large number of vaccines are now being produced from aborted babies. They're grown in human tissue. If you are categorically opposed to abortion, you're categorically to benefiting off of the murder of others. Does the state have the power to force you to use such a vaccine? And you don't have to be part of a religious group. Right now, we require that you have to be part of a religious group that doesn't take any vaccines in order to be exempt. Now, if you want to not take vaccines, that implies some responsibility, because does the school, the public school, have the power, or any school for that matter, have the power to say, no, you can't attend here because your children aren't vaccinated and you're putting the other children at risk? Surely. So if you're going to say, no, I won't take vaccines, it may come with a price. But does the state have the power to categorically say, no, you cannot refuse? Based on whatever moral rectitude you choose to have. Your conscience is your own.
Are there any limits on that at all? Or?
Not here.
So in the case...
Yeah, go ahead. No, this is where it gets going.
So in the case, you know, where we have the people who are going to get married and gay married, they don't want to sell, they don't want to make the cake, and that's, you know, that's making all kinds of national news. So whether you agree with that or that, obviously, in the case of these folks, that's an act of conscience. Mm-hmm. So if other people decide, look, if we don't think that's right, we're not going to do business with those folks anymore, that's the consequence mm-hmm. of that. Mm-hmm. But what is the legal? You're saying that there is no legal power at all to address those people. You can boycott the business as a private citizen. So if that was to happen in New Hampshire, how would that situation play itself out?
Constitutionally, the state should have no power to force you to participate in something that is against your conscience. However, there's another little wrinkle here. We have a practice known as franchise, also known as incorporation, LLC, PPC. Until the 1960s, all such entities were created in the state legislature. In the 1960s, the legislature delegated that to the Secretary of State as a ministerial function. However, in contrast to a proprietorship, me, myself, and I, I'm part of two businesses. One is my original engineering business, Christofferson Engineering. It is a sole proprietorship. I take full liability for what I do. I have taken no franchise from the state. Franchise is defined as a power granted by the state to do business in a manner not available to the general public. That is the legal definition, Black's Law. When you incorporate, you surrender a certain amount of your sovereignty. You have to give an accounting of your business to the state every year. You cannot change your scope of business without a mother may I from the state. The state can choose to dissolve your business at any time it so chooses. All incorporations were originally legislative acts, just like the incorporation of towns. Towns, counties are political subdivisions of the state. In the most literal sense, any incorporated business is a political subdivision of the state. So, how much sovereignty do you surrender? If you are incorporated, can the state say, yes, you must serve everybody? But Mr. Sole Proprietorship over here, the only benefit I have is that my business name is trademarked, nobody else can be Christopher's Engineering in the state of New Hampshire. But I'm not absolved of any legal liability, which means I have to do a really good job. I've surrendered another of my conscience in my business dealings. Has an incorporated business created essentially by the state according to the, it has a form of government prescribed by the state. State says you must have these members of your board of directors. Once you've signed up to do this is the business you must do and no other. Every year you have to tell us how you've done this business and give us an accounting of it. You have to give an annual report of your business. Have they surrendered that? That's a question for us in the legislature. Oh, what tangled webs we weave. Unfortunately, you know, 100 years ago, everybody knew what incorporation was and what franchise was. It was one of the big debates in the first administration of the federal government. There was the issue of the federal bank, First Federal Bank. And Washington asked Hamilton and Jefferson for an astute opinion. Did the governor of the United States have the power of franchise? Had that been delegated to the general government? Everybody believed that the states had that power. Hamilton came back with his treatise on why franchise had been delegated as part of what is necessary to execute the law, you know, to execute the laws. If you're going to have a monetary system, then you have to have a central bank. So you have to have the power to franchise. Jefferson came back and said, no, that is not specifically delegated, therefore it's reserved to the state. Hamilton won. But this is a recognized power of government. We used to, as a legislature, we used to franchise individual lotteries. Lotteries were illegal, but we would allow people to have a lottery to raise money to start a business. We gave franchises to put ferries and such across rivers because you didn't want a ferry every 10 feet, so you franchised out where the ferries could be. PS&H was created by the legislature in 1915. I have the incorporation paper, a copy of the legislative act summary at home on my computer. It's all our fault. Let's move on to, that was Article 4. Article 5, which is our religious. Now, the religion is recognized as a right of conscience, but it is because rights of conscience, remember, rights of conscience are absolute. No equivalent to be given or received for it. And therefore, when there is a little bit of a stricture on rights of religion, is specifically addressed in the Constitution. And that's an important concept. Every individual has a natural and unalienable right to worship God according to the dictates of his own conscience. Okay, that's the pure Article 4 part of it. And reason. And no subject shall be hurt molested, or restrained in his person, liberty, or estate for worshiping God in the manner and season most agreeable to the dictates of his own conscience or his religious profession. In sentiments or persuasion, provided he does not disturb the public peace or disturb others in their religious worship. So if your religious worship were to require going down the streets at 1 o'clock in the morning banging a drum, there'd be some objection to it. Or if you remember I keep forgetting the name, the Baptists, the people who protested military funerals. Okay? Westboro Baptists. Their protest of a funeral is an infringement upon the religious practice of others, religious worship of others. We had a bill specifically addressing that issue back in like 2008. The way we resolved it was that nobody can protest within 500 feet of any funeral. Because even if somebody's an atheist, a funeral is a solemn occasion. You're sending your beloved to whatever the hereafter contains. And so that was how we solved that problem, according to the dictates of Article 5. Sure. That's what we're here for.
Contemporary and may I, as a Christian, object to the five times your prayer in Psalm of the State of the House of the Town of the Word, which is in here in live services at particular times, I guess?
If they're truly interfering with your prayers, I mean, if they weren't praying in your...
I didn't hear the question.
Do you repeat it?
Louder. I was just trying to, as we know, the Muslims have prayed five times a day, and lasted throughout the whole community. So as a Baptist, I may be having a service, I could be having a service at the same time that these loudspeakers are blowing us out of the county, out of the city. And my question was, how would we address that in an optimal body?
And I think that would be a perfect exercise. We would have legitimate authority to say that however they did it, that they couldn't be of such a volume or nature that it interfered with other people's prayer time or other people's, you know, they can't use it to blast into your house. Now, if they're out in the middle of the woods somewhere with their mosque, and nobody but the birds and the bees can hear their publicly broadcast prayers, who cares? If they're in the middle of town, we would certainly be able to set a noise limit that's no more harsh than any other noise. That would be perfectly reasonable. Just like we set noise limits on motorcycle exhausts. I probably use the same value just for the sake of uniformity. Or we don't allow fireworks after 10 o'clock at night, I think, or something like that. Is that the, you know, specific exemption? You know. And basically the rule of thumb is most police departments will never make an objection. If you're off blowing fireworks and somebody at midnight and somebody complains, they'll come over and tell you to shut it down. If nobody complains, they won't. Next one, well, I'm gonna come back to the next one. Article 6, after we've gone through the others. Yeah?
One question, going back to the Westboro Baptist Church, the religious issue, what about their constitutional First Amendment right to their free speech?
Well, they're as long like as their free speech doesn't interfere with the religious worship of others, they're cool. That's why we set a 500-foot limit. 500 feet away from a grave site should be adequate to give the people the privacy they need. And they can go stand out there, and in fact, we had word at the time that they were planning to come protest some military funerals, and guess what? They didn't show up because they wanted to disturb the religious worship of others. If they couldn't make things miserable for other people, they didn't want to be there. Problem solved. Article 7 is kind of cool. They're all kind of cool, but Article 7 is cool. It's title state sovereignty. It's more extensive than that, but it's interesting because It was part of our 1784 Constitution, which we don't have anymore, by the way. That's another little aside. We ratified our Constitution in 1784. It was enrolled. Then in 1791, we had another Constitutional Convention as prescribed in the Constitution. And we made a lot of changes. We changed from the very parliamentary form of government that we had in the 1784 Constitution to what we have now, where executive councils are directly elected. And we lost a lot of connection between the executive and legislative branches. And the governor was no longer the president of the Senate. There were over 100 amendments in 1790, proposed in 1791 and approved in 1792. So it was so extensive that they re-enrolled the whole Constitution. That's the parchment version that we have. During that period from 1784 until 1819, when we went into the state house that we now occupy, we were kind of a vagabond legislature, like the Israelites wandering into the wilderness. We met in whatever city would give us meeting space. Portsmouth, Exeter, you know, so we kind of traveled around. We lost the 1784 version. They were elected to the same districts as state reps. I don't know in particular, but in that period, it would have been on the order of 70 or so, I believe. There was a rep for every 150 landholders with estates more than 50 pounds. I think it was about that number, yeah.
Is it my understanding that New Hampshire, therefore, was both the first and last of the original 13?
Yes, that's a very important point. Yes, we were the first, we were also the last. Very often, and I'll point out some particulars later, but because we were the last constitution, it's really a review of all the state constitutions. It's often phrased as a knockoff on the Massachusetts Constitution that we just kind of took theirs and rewrote it as our own. Now, as testament against that, they don't have Article 1. The concepts in Article 1 are throughout. They have an equivalent to our Article 8 that we'll touch on later. They have an equivalent to our Article 10, which we'll talk about later. They have the equivalent to our Article 2. They're not necessarily the same numbers, but the thoughts are there. So does Maryland. Most other states, and being an engineer, I have a nice little spreadsheet that I put into my commentary. And I go through and you know, it's nice to be able to do word searches. And so I look for keywords with some of the fundamental liberties. Consent. General. Good, you know, and went through each state constitution and identified about 15 fundamental liberties. Only the New Hampshire Constitution has all of them, either implicit, like our original right to keep and bear arms, or explicit. Article 10, again, a testament to the fact that ours is not a knockoff of Massachusetts. The form of our Article 10, which there is an equivalent of in Massachusetts, Pennsylvania, and one other, and Maryland, ours is identical to Maryland, not Massachusetts. So what our founders did when they were looking at our Bill of Rights in 1781 is they went through all of the state constitutions and they plucked out the best and where necessary rewrote it a little bit, like Article 1. And that's why we're the only ones that have Article 1 that really, they said, we are a Lockean social contract. All the others have all the same elements throughout their Bill of Rights, if they have a Bill of Rights, and not all do, or did. But we're the only ones that boiled it down to 27 words.
So it was re-enrolled in 1791, basically.
Well, 1792.
1792. Now, why does it call it the Constitution of 1784?
Because we like that date, it's older.
Oh.
And it's fairly, I mean, the form of government changed substantially. The Bill of Rights didn't change. I mean, there were some word changes, but nothing dramatic in the Bill of Rights. But the importance of looking at Article 7 relative to 84, relative to the federal Constitution. When we ratified that article in 1784, it was before the current Constitution for the United States. Right? In 1792, it's after. So we had the same view of ourselves in 1792 after the Constitution of the United States as we did before. The people of this state have the sole and exclusive right of governing themselves as a free, sovereign, and independent state. And those words, free, sovereign, independent state, were in the Articles of Confederation. And do it forever hereafter shall exercise and enjoy every power, jurisdiction, and right pertaining thereto, which is not or may not hereafter be by them expressly delegated to the United States of America in Congress assembled. And it's not just the state sovereignty. The people of this state have the sole and exclusive right of governing themselves as a free, sovereign, and independent state. So it also deals with personal sovereignty. And I'll give you a great one. I included in the book, my favorite researcher, Rich Lambert, found for me a letter from the legislature of New Hampshire to then President Jefferson. Let's see if I can find this. I mean, there we go. And it's important because if you think about the way things go through the House and the Senate, there's a lot of massaging that goes along. If you look, some of you are, I'm sure,
familiar. Is that massaging or misogyny?
Massaging.
Okay.
In the Kentucky resolutions, and Virginia resolution, which were authored by Madison and Jefferson, and were the basis of something I did back in 2009. If you read what they proposed and what the legislatures passed, it's hard to even recognize it as the same document. And if you look at what Virginia passed and what Kentucky passed, they are very disparate. I mean, if you read the original, and Virginia took one set of concepts, and Kentucky took a different set of concepts. All in the original, but there's very little cross. So in 1804, I believe, the legislature of New Hampshire, must be a little after 1804, the legislature of New Hampshire wrote a letter to President Jefferson, because at that time we were considering secession, as were all the New England states, because of a law regarding trading with France. And we were also very upset at the Louisiana Purchase, which he had done without legislative authority. And just really want to find that. I should do a dog ear on the page. Because what happens is that the legislature of New Hampshire, being assembled and realizing that the present is to our country a momentous period, and sensible that the bond of confederation, this is 1804, 1808, there we go, 1808, so we're well after the Constitution. Note they think of the United States as a confederation. The bond of confederation, which connects the independent states of America, is strengthened by unanimity alone between the National Council and the state legislatures. And not ignorant that the present crisis in our national affairs has excited the present humors that occasionally afflict the national system, you know, the Louisiana Purchase thing, and mar the fair prospect of our political institutions. And they go on to make some backhanded compliments to the effect that, yeah, we really don't approve of it, but it costs less in blood and treasure than a war would have to acquire the same territory. So, you know, but we regarded ourselves, the legislature, as a sovereign and independent state. And that the United States was a confederation. There's a reason for that. I go to it in the book. But if you go back to 1781, the words federation, confederation, alliance, treaty, they're all synonyms. The Constitution for the United States is, in effect, a treaty between the states. It's a very different concept than what we, the way we think about it now. But when they wrote it, that's what they were thinking. That is the true power that it is intended to have. It's not a suicide pact. Now we come to Article 8. Another great article. Another one that's been totally bastardized. And this again speaks back to Article 1. All power residing originally in and being derived from the people. All the magistrates and officers, I lost my place here. All the and officers of government are their agents, substitutes and agents, and at all times accountable to them, period. That's where it ended in 1784. So we were accountable to the people continuously, always, without exception. And then in 1976, we saw fit to amend it to say, government therefore shall be open and accessible and accountable and responsive. Okay. To that end, the public's right of access to governmental proceedings and records shall not be unreasonably restricted. What's the flip side of the accessibility of records should not be unreasonably restricted? They can be reasonably restricted. Okay, what's the reasonable restriction? Who decides what the reasonable restriction is? Should it be government? Or should it be the people? Who's in charge? Who's supposed to be in charge? You take what was, I'm sure, purported to be a great advance in making government records accessible to the people, and you absolutely flipped it around from being at all times accountable to accountable when government felt like it, when it wasn't inconvenient.
Well, let's say you got into a situation, though, where you have a non-public session prior to this being amended, and I don't know the history like you do, were non-public sessions illegal?
Yeah.
So let's say you were talking about a negotiation or something to deal with an employee at your town, you know, disciplinary actions or whatever, and those might be brought up in non-public session now. Were they brought up in public session in the
best of my knowledge, they were. Of course, I'm sure they didn't really have that many employees.
And whose employee are they?
I mean, and you can see in the description of the legislature the kind of threshold because we set ourselves, or the people set a threshold for us in 1792, I think. Maybe it was in 81, let's see. I've got to get to the form of government. And it has to deal with the doors of the gallery being required to be open. And the Constitution requires that the, again, look at the title and then kind of erase the title and think what they're really saying. Article 8, open sessions of legislature. Now erase that title and listen to what it really says. The doors of the galleries of each house of the legislature shall be kept open to all persons who behave decently, except when the welfare of the state, in their opinion, of either branch, shall require secrecy.
What is that again?
Part 2, Article 8. So the level of...
So he's Part 2, Article 8?
Yes. So the level of what was required to close the doors of the gallery was the issues you were considering had to be so... That if you didn't keep them secret, the future of the state was in peril. Okay? So you're talking about invasion or something of that level of magnitude. You're not talking about we don't want the people, you know, the people are being annoying and we don't want them watching. And part of the problem is that we probably don't exercise our power to hold people in contempt adequately either. You know, when somebody is mocking the legislature or legislators from the gallery, we have the power to throw them in jail. We have the power to fine them. And well, we haven't really had that many obnoxious incidences. But we, you know, look at Congress a couple weeks ago when the Democrats sat down on the floor of Congress. They should have been held in contempt. They were being contemptuous of the whole process. And you think about what being held in contempt would have done. Okay? The only way they could be held in contempt is that there's a vote of the legislature. Right? So, if they don't get up off the floor and get into their seats to vote, it's going to be unanimous. Right? So you would have broken the whole thing right there if the speaker had some guts. Because once they're off the floor, then they're off the floor, they're no longer sitting in, and life goes back to the proper sequence of events that it ought to. But, you know, you can't, government, our accountability to the people is supposed to be absolute. Now, I can see, you know, if, now that we have employees like we have, and you might have health issues or real private issues, personal issues that might be in a personnel file that you really don't want public to have general access to. But look at the police departments hiding disciplinary actions against officers for having abused members of the public in personnel files. That's the kind of thing that ought to be out there front and center. Any member of government, whether they're a bureaucrat in Health and Human Services or a teacher or a police officer, if they have been offending members of the public, and the resolution of that, whether for them or against them, ought to be in the public record. That's not a privacy issue. That's an accountability issue.
Prior to this amendment, was that so?
I would presume so. I don't know. On the other hand, we might have convinced the people of an amendment to legitimize what we were already doing.
certainly entering the right to negotiation. And the antics that we held in the alley. Did you go so far to say that was a situation which might have been a little bit competitive?
Detainment? Detaining people?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Repeat the question, please.
Back in the right to work legislation in 2012, that ultimately resulted in the closing of the doors of the gallery. Is that a situation that could have resulted in people in the gallery being held in contempt? And my answer was yes, and I was one of the members of leadership, and there were a number of us, who voted not to uphold the speaker's decision.
Speaker's decision to file?
No, it was speaker's decision to close the gallery.
Oh.
There are a number of things I would have done differently. I mean, I might have set up a remote location that, say in room 201 and 202, the finance division, our chamber, with a remote TV that people were so disruptive as to prevent the proceedings from going on, that they would be ordered to leave and say, you can go watch over there, you know, but you're not going to disrupt the proceedings. And kept the doors open. there were a number of Al voted to not uphold the speaker's ruling, and Representative Ingerson, Representative Mirsky. We were all called into the office. Say, why did you do that? We said, because you were wrong. Article 9 is very straightforward. No big surprises. No place or office whatsoever in government should be hereditary. The abilities of requisite, you know, the abilities, integrity, requisite, and all not being transmissible to posterity or relations. So anybody can have an idiot for a child. And any idiot can have a brilliant child. That's pretty banal. Article 10 is the one that's more exciting. Article 10, as I said, reads exactly like Maryland's Article 10. And it really should be thought-provoking to us, not only just in what it says, but in what we do. Government being instituted for the common benefit. So there's that general good, common good concept there. Okay? The purpose of government is for the general good. That whatever it is we do up in Concord, we can't diminish it, anybody's condition. We can only improve it. That's the first rule of government. For the common benefit, protection, and security of the whole community, and not for the private emolument or interest of any one man, family, or class of men. Therefore, whenever the ends of government are perverted and the public liberty manifestly in danger, and all other means of redress are ineffectual, the people may, and of a right ought, to reform the old or establish a new government. The doctrine of non-resistance against arbitrary power and oppression is absurd, slavish, and destructive of the good happiness of mankind. That last sentence, but only Maryland uses the word ought other than us, and only Maryland has that last sentence, like us. Daniel Webster quoted that on the floor of Congress in a debate on nullification. And he said, the Constitution of my state teaches me the doctrine of non-resistance against arbitrary power and oppression is absurd, slavish, and destructive of the good and happiness of mankind. What is arbitrary power and oppression? Anybody give a single word to that?
Tyranny.
Tyranny. It is the definition of tyranny. Tyranny is most characterized by arbitrariness. Again, it's phrased the right of revolution. But what word is buried in there? Special word. Most powerful word. Ought. The people may and of a right ought to reform the old or establish a new government. It is not merely a right of revolution, it is an obligation of revolution. Think about that. We have when the public liberty is manifestly endangered, we have an obligation of revolution. That's how highly our founders prized their liberty. I'm going to take a break here for a moment. It's actually going to let me eat a couple things. And I'm going to give you 5 minutes.
Thank you.
And I'm going to kick you in the shins when you go over five.
Brand name. Jim Rubens for U.S. Senate. Hello, folks. Let's see. I think I know about half of you here. So I'm running for U.S. Senate, running for a few reasons, one of which is to give voters in New Hampshire a choice, because the incumbent, Kelly Ayotte and Maggie Hassan, are remarkably similar in their viewpoints. And your subject here is the Constitution. They're remarkably similar in the extent to which they are perfectly willing to shred the Constitution.
So we're back at Article 10. I'm going to pick on Senator Rubin on a couple of things. He mentioned one thing. He talked about delegating down. And if you look at the structure of our republics, is that some things have never been delegated up. He mentioned about the Department of Federal Involvement of Education. When Senator Rubens and I were in high school, I think you're about the same vintage as myself, give or take. When we were in high school, I graduated in 1976. The United States was still number one in the world. Nobody could hold a candle to our educational system. Who can tell me when the Department of Education was created? 1978, under President Carter. And it's been downhill ever since. Just think about that. Could you have accomplished bringing the number one educational system from down to number 20-something in effectively two educational generations by accident? Just a thought.
How much as a percentage of the overall education spending in the state comes from the federal government?
A remarkably minuscule amount. It's about 14%.
6%.
6%. Yeah. 6%. Now, so if the federal government contributes 6%, if we didn't have to comply with all the federal regulations, do you think we could deliver a better product for less than 94% of what we're spending?
But if they don't have the constitutional power, but they have the money stick, kind of small money stick. Why has there not been, in the succeeding decade, some pushback?
Because we believe we're getting something for nothing.
But it's not.
It's that simple.
It's not this common core situation, perhaps one of those paradigm shifts maybe in people's thinking. We may be able to capitalize on that a little bit.
Do you think Common Core Goals 2000, or what was it before Goals 2000?
I was following for that.
Goals 2000. You mentioned it.
I was Goals 2000 when I was in the State Senate.
Right, and it was something. Goals 2000 was a retread.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
No Child Left Behind.
No, that was after.
That was
Common Core.
No, that's after that. Yeah. So it was. And there was something before, but anyway, it's this retread of the same groupthink and degradation in education. And they just, and every time it comes out, because I remember fighting Goals 2000. I wasn't in the legislature, but I remember fighting it in the late 90s. Everybody gets upset, and so they rename it. But it's
new and improved.
Absurdity, yeah. I mean, new and improved horse hockey is still horse hockey. But let's go back to Article 10. So it's an obligation of revolution. The people ought to reform the old or establish a new government. But what's really interesting is the threshold. Because the threshold is difficult to define. It's a nebulous threshold. When the public liberty is manifestly endangered, when the ends of government are perverted, so when we're no longer really working for the common good, which means everybody has to be left in no worse state than they started in, the public liberty is manifestly endangered. How would you define the public liberty being manifestly endangered? Well, is that really public liberty? That, I think, really falls more under the common good kind of thing. Public liberty. Maybe when you are afraid to speak your mind in public for fear of retribution from the government. Freedom of speech, freedom of expression, freedom of assembly.
Thank you.
You're welcome. When you no longer feel free to exercise those fundamental liberties without retribution from the government, like maybe not participating in a marriage with which you hold philosophical disagreements, or you'll go to jail. Is that the public liberty manifestly endangered? Remember, and this is another thing, important thing to remember, the Constitution, generally speaking, doesn't protect one citizen from another. It's really about protecting the citizens from government. So freedom of speech is not protecting me to say what I want from you. That's the laws the legislature creates. Freedom of speech is me being able to say what I want without fear from the government silencing me. Public liberty is manifestly endangered. And all other means of redress are ineffectual. What means of redress do you have? Ballot box? You keep going to the ballot box and electing different people, but they keep doing the same thing? We have actually a constitutionally, and this is another important concept, most of what we see in the Constitution are what I would call negative rights, in that they prohibit the government from doing something. The good senator, and I call him senator, not because he's a federal senator, but because he was a state senator, that's a title he retains for life. The good senator made a comment that the Constitution gives us the right to keep and bear arms. No. It does not give us the right to keep and bear arms. We have the right to keep and bear arms. It recognizes that right. Very important distinction. It's a natural right. It comes from creator, or just by the very, the if you don't believe in a creator, it comes from the fact of your humanity. You have that natural right. So there's another kind of right. We have very few positive rights. A positive right would be something that government, that exists because of government. Voting would be an example of a positive right. If there's no government, there's nobody to vote for, right? So it exists only because of government. In our Constitution, we have a positive right of redress before the legislature. If the government injures us, we have the right to have that injury presented to the legislature and, if possible, made right. So that's another means of redress that we have under our Constitution. So if all other means of redress are ineffectual, then we have the obligation to change the government, whether it's amend the Constitution or to just wipe all the chess pieces off the board and start over. But it's important to us because we, the legislature, are ultimately the first guardians of the public liberty. We make the laws that the rest of government follows. It's not the courts. Who does the Constitution give the job of enforcing the Constitution to? Part 1, Article 38, the people have the right to require. Who do the people elect? They elect us. Who do they elect most directly? The representatives. We represent nominally 3,500 people? 3,300 people. Senators represent nominally 50,000. The governor represents the whole body public. The judges, they represent no one. I wasn't really planning to go into it here, but there's a very important concept out of Locke, and that is legislative supremacy. That because it's the legislature that is accountable to the people, it's the legislature that holds all the power. We see this in our Constitution in Part 1, Article 29. We also see it in Article 37, where in the order in which the powers of government are listed, they list the ones with the most power first. It's a marvelous concept. They gave, and even within the legislature, I'll present this in a couple of weeks when we have the second class, but I can diagram out for you how the House is the most powerful body in government. We have one of the attributes are that we are the closest people, the fewest number of people elect us, so we are the most accountable. We also individually, within our branch of government, we individually exercise the least power. Each of us exercises at best 1/400th of the power. The Senate has a little less power. Each senator has 1/24th of the power. The governor and council have a little less power. The governor has 50%, and each of the councilors has 10%, because they require a majority. So each one of them has 20% of the other 50% of the executive. And judges, who are elected by nobody, have plenary power within their courtroom and pertaining to their case. But only in that room.
I'd like to, this is something broad that we can play. I know what this might represent. I'm also a town's chair. We're all aware, most of us should be aware of what happened with the Claremont decision.
Mm-hmm.
The legislature didn't do anything about it. Worse than that, it's my understanding that the courts themselves broke the law, their own laws, by allowing unqualified judges to make a ruling on that thing. Why is it that, two things, nothing was done at the time and nothing is being done now?
We have...
Restate the question, please.
I will restate the question. The question is, why did the legislature not hitch up its pants and take the court to task when they passed Claremont 2? And that really... Thank you. You have to understand, Claremont 2, son of Claremont 1, ended with the courts telling the legislature how they must write the law. And that is not something within the judicial purview. This brings up what was the original interplay that was supposed to happen between the courts and the legislature and the executive. The court over the years has presumed the authority to tell the rest of government that a law is unconstitutional and therefore should not be practiced. So let's go to Article 29. Because this is the meat of the matter. And this is actually what led me to write the commentary in the first place. Or led to my writing the commentary in the first place. Back in, this is after Claremont II, but back in 2006, we had passed, as we always do every 2 years, we had passed a law that said this is how the ballot should look, this is how the names will appear on the ballot, this is the column that the Republicans will be in, and this is the column the Democrats will be in. And a number of people challenged how the ballot was to appear. And they brought this idea of primacy forward. The idea of primacy was that, especially when you have a multi-candidate district, or a multi-seat district, like a legislative district with, you know, like say 13 reps, the guy at the top gets more votes than the guy at the bottom, because that's just what people are going to do. What they're really saying, and nobody said it this way, is that the people of New Hampshire, they thought they were too stupid to find their candidate's name on the ballot, listed in alphabetical order. And I found Article 29. The power of suspending the laws or the execution of them ought never to be exercised but by the legislature, or authority derived therefrom, to be exercised in such particular cases as only as the legislature shall expressly provide for. So nobody other than the legislature has the power to start or stop a law. You think about how do you get rid of a law? How do you take a law off the books? You repeal it. It's a legislative act. So when the courts say a law is unconstitutional and therefore can't be practiced anymore, they are committing a legislative act. Part 2, Article 4, I believe, says all legislative power shall be vested in a general court. Okay, is that it? No, Article 2. The supreme legislative power within this state shall be vested in the Senate and House of Representatives. Who is supreme? We are. Does the court have the power to suspend a law? No, only the legislature shall suspend a law. So I made this argument that the court didn't have the power to tell the Secretary of State not to publish the ballot in the manner that we had prescribed. And my arguments were sufficiently forceful to get the House and the Senate to call themselves into session and to pass House order telling the Secretary of State to publish the ballot the way in which we prescribed. Came out of the Senate, went over to the House. Unfortunately, I couldn't be there that day. I was away on other important business. And my colleagues in the House amended the bill with words from my emails. Unfortunately, the Senate had adjourned and could not concur with the amendments. And so the measure failed. And we now have, the alphabet doesn't necessarily begin with A. It begins with the letter of the election. Sometimes K, sometimes O, whatever. And Paul Mirsky said I've done such a good job of arguing for Article 29 that I really ought to write a commentary on the Constitution, which forced me to read the whole thing and figure out something to say about each article. And I found a multitude of gems along the way. But how did they practice? And this is another important thing. When you're looking at the Constitution, you have a constitutional quandary. What was the intent of the article? Go back and see what the guys that wrote the silly thing did. How did they practice the Constitution that they wrote? Well, in, I think, 1786, you've got to understand, 1780s, and the economy is in great turmoil, huge inflation, continental dollars not worth anything. And so the legislature, and we had Article 20, or one Article 20, which at that time gave a right to trial by jury in all cases without exception. And so the legislature passed what they called the 10-pound act. We were still measuring money in pounds at the time. And the 10-pound act said that if you had a controversy with a value of less than 10 pounds, then you could take it to the local justice of the peace, which is, you know, like a, it's a judicial hearing, not a jury hearing. And I can't remember the names of the individuals, but there was a controversy over a pair of shoes hadn't been paid for, and the shopkeeper took the guy with the shoes to court. Turned out that he had given the shopkeeper some other things of value, but still ended up with a debt of 2 pounds. And the judge found in favor of the shopkeeper. The fellow with the shoes then appealed it from the to the inferior court. We had justices of the peace, county inferior courts, and then a superior court that held much the same role as our current Supreme Court, but was a true circuit court, and that it traveled around the state and held hearings of appeal. So they appealed the justice of the peace decision to the inferior court, and the inferior court was about to ratify the original result, and the respondent's attorney, the guy who had the shoes, suddenly stood up and said, "It's unconstitutional per Article 20. My client had a right to a trial by jury in the first instance." So the inferior court ruled in favor of the shopkeeper and then arrested their decision. So they only worked within their courtroom. They stayed within their jurisdiction. They arrested their decision. For the next 18 months, people would under the 10-pound act, take something to a justice of the peace. It would be appealed to an inferior court. Somebody would say it's unconstitutional per Article 20. The courts would find whoever they found in favor of, and then they would arrest their decision. And after 18 months, the legislature was really angry that the judges weren't just using the 10-pound act. And so they tried to impeach the judges. And the impeachment failed. And so the legislature then repealed the 10-pound act because it was, in fact, unconstitutional. That's the interplay that our founders envisioned. It wasn't that a judicial opinion nullified the law, because one of the things, under common law, and this is one, why do we have a constitution? Why do we have statutes? Great Britain doesn't have a constitution. It migrates over time according to legislative acts. Under common law, the law mutates over time according to the last judicial decision. Today, the penalty for stealing may be having a brand on your thumb, and 20 years from now, it may be cutting your thumb off. Statute law fixes the state's position. I had somebody tell me, well, statute law only restricts the state. And he said it in the manner that he said, that thinking that you couldn't be held accountable under statute law. And of course, that's absurdity. But if you think of what statute law does, it says to the state, you can only impose this penalty for this act. So in fact, it does restrict the state. It takes the power out of the hands of the judges and puts it in the legislature, which is directly accountable to the people.
Is there a seminal decision at the state level that enshrines judicial review the same way that Marbury v. Madison does at the federal level?
Yes and no. There is not particularly a Marbury v. Madison decision, but there is Merrill v. Sherburne. in which the judiciary exempted themselves from redress of grievances. And I told you, redress of grievances is your right to have the wrong done you and the grievances you suffer heard by the legislature by petition, written, or remonstrance spoken. And in fact, for the first 35 years of our legislature, of our state, that is how most legislation entered the building, as a result of a petition. Government would injure somebody, and the state and the legislature would figure out what to do about it, whether it was paying somebody back, or changing the statutes, or whatever was necessary to remedy the situation. And most often, it was the judiciary that was the object of petitions for redress. And typically, the judiciary would have deprived somebody of due process, and they'd cry foul, and the legislature would look at it and say, yep, you didn't follow the laws we wrote on due process. Do over. They didn't reverse decisions, as was alleged, but they would say that the loss of due process had nullified the decision, and please follow due process, and it doesn't matter whether you end up with the same result or a different result. That's not the issue. The issue was one of due process. Great example is a woman by the name of Elizabeth Clary, who was away in England. Somebody, a relative died, or a friend had died, and she was unapprised of the will reading and hearing. And the state awarded it to somebody else. She got back, she had the will, she said, I've been injured because I didn't get the due process of the will, I wasn't apprised of everything. And in fact, the other party agreed. The legislature said do over, and everything was made right. Well, in 1819, we are now 35 years out from the founding of the state. And though not individually significant, it's also the year John Langdon died. He had now been out of politics for about 6 years. The reason I cite that is because where we are in history is the people who wrote the Constitution are disappearing from the political scene. And you have a decision of Merrill versus Sherburne. I forget what the underlying case was. But there was a loss of due process and a judicial process, and petition for redress was made, and legislature said do over. Also, another thing that happened was there was a transition in the legislature, not unlike what we've had in the last few years. In 1816, the Federalists were taken out of power. The Anti-Federalists were in power. They kicked out all the judges. The people actually kept going to the old judges, no longer in office. We had annual elections, so two election cycles later, the people switched back to the Federalists. You've now had two complete exchanges of the legislature. So you have very few people with legislative history. So there's nobody to stand up and say, but I remember, right? It's 1819. Langdon's dead. You've had two exchanges of the legislature. And the judiciary takes Merrill versus Sherburne, and this is generally true, and we might discuss other cases along the way, where when the judiciary is doing a little sleight of hand, they'll make a really long argument up front. And kind of what I call the fulcrum paragraph. I mean, one paragraph will hold the totality of their real argument. And then a really long therefore section. And in the fulcrum argument, they say they're talking about, first of all, how I can't remember his name now. French political philosopher, Montesquieu, wrote about the English form of government in contrast to French. He's a great fan of English over French government. And the fact that in the English government, no branch of government fully exercised the power of another branch of government, and how this was the way it should be. And so he makes this argument, and the judiciary takes Montesquieu. They quote him out of context, as though he were saying that one branch of government should not exercise any of the power of another branch. And then said, and Madison said, this is the very definition of tyranny. And he's only discussing legislative and judicial. Now, if you read Madison in Federalist Paper 47, what Madison actually says, when you read Montesquieu, you know, they took one sentence fragment out of Montesquieu and misapplied it. Madison makes the whole paragraph quote out of Montesquieu and says, of course, everybody knows what Montesquieu is arguing against is complete agency, because he's arguing in favor of the British form of government in which there's only partial agency. And then he goes on to say, when all three powers of government, legislative, executive, and judicial, notice the order, rest in the same set of hands, whether elected, hereditary, I forget what the third option is, this may be termed the very definition of tyranny. So they took a fragmentary quote out of Madison, misapplied it. Madison is actually making exactly the opposite argument of what the judiciary was. And this is their justification why the legislature should not be able to suspend a judicial decision and say do-over. And in their conclusion, they and I'll paraphrase here, but it's not much of a paraphrase. They say that the people who wrote the Constitution, ratified the Constitution, and practiced the Constitution for the first 35 years did not understand what they had created. And it took us to properly interpret it and tell you that redress against the judiciary is unacceptable. From that point on, people ceased to seek redress against the judiciary. And though there was no constitutional justification for it, the judiciary began to hear redress by the people against other branches of government. And so by the time you get to the 20th century, nobody's practicing constitutional redress at all. Now, if you look at the way our Constitution is set up, remember that one indissoluble fabric? Article 17, Part 1, Article 17, gives clear jurisdiction of the courts to criminal matters. The people, the state against an individual or individuals. You gotta check me out, make sure I'm right on that. It's Article 17. I'm 95% sure. And Article 20, which deals with jury trials in civil cases, clearly gives the judiciary jurisdiction over cases between two or more individuals. But in cases of individuals against the state, it clearly gives jurisdiction to the general court. We actually have exclusive jurisdiction in that area. Why? Why would they give us exclusive jurisdiction in matters of people against the state? Well, what if the remedy for the problem requires that the individual be paid money? Who has the power to order money out of the Treasury? Only we do. What if the remedy requires a change to the law? Who has the power to change the law? Only we do. It's a remarkably magnificent system. When the problem is the government, the jurisdiction is given to the general court, not to the judicatories of the state. Also remember that until 1974, all the judicatories of the state were creations of whom? The legislature. Who has the power to remove a legislator? Who has the power to remove a legislator? No one except the people, right? And only at the time of election. Who has the power to remove a judge? We do. If you have been injured by the government, where is the most effectual place to go? The legislature. We hold the purse strings, we create the courts. Even though there are now a constitutional supreme and superior court, who has the power to change their jurisdiction? Who has the power to say how many judges there are? Right. Best as luck would happen.
In a case where you had a legislature, and I hear what you're saying with the 10-pound example and stuff like that. But let's say you had a legislature totally went off the tracks, and said, in the interest of public safety, we're going to set up free speech zones. You can only exercise your right of public in these free speech zones. The court comes down and says, whoa, have you read this thing? That's totally not constitutional. So if the legislature does not go back and, is not held by that, so then you just go back, you have a right of revolution.
Play that scenario out in its reality. Okay, how does the judiciary get an opportunity to say that the free speech zone is unconstitutional?
Somebody would bring an action.
Okay, right. And then the court would do what? Find in the plaintiff's favor.
Correct.
The decision only holds within that case. According to statutory law. And look at how they did it with the 10-pound act.
Yeah.
So when the people see time after time after time the free speech zone getting ruled unconstitutional, what are they going to do? They're going to elect different legislators who will repeal the law. Politics is supposed to be slow and messy. Fast and powerful is extremely dangerous. That's Nazi Germany. Most efficient government in the history of man. According to Star Trek, anyway. Day 10. Anything else? Anywhere else you want our thoughts to wander?
Well, I would just like to see us wander back to the fact that over the states since 1974, for example, those of us, all of us who were and have been in our election, have really been navigating our responsibilities.
Okay, and who is supposed to hold us accountable?
The electorate.
And what are they supposed to? What are they supposed to do? As described, because the Constitution can't force anybody to do it. Though the people can force us to comply with the Constitution, right? It says, a frequent recurrence of the fundamental principles of the Constitution. To read, study, and discuss the Constitution. These are the kinds of discussions that should be happening over the cracker barrel, as it were. How often do you see people talking about the what the Constitution of New Hampshire means?
They're too busy on Facebook.
Yeah. Well, now they are. They weren't in 74.
No, that's true.
But that would be a great place to discuss it on Facebook.
Hey,
there you go. I mean, in a sense, for those of us who have a passion for the Constitution, we have the opportunity to engage people as to what it means. I mean, Bill will tell you, I can get people going on the Constitution. I had a gallery full one day. That was one of the times when maybe people should have been held in contempt. Scared the pants off the Democrats. Were you there that day?
I'm not sure.
Article HCR 9?
Yeah.
Yeah, under Terry Norelli. And the following December, the Democrats made it illegal to carry guns in the State House. Oh, we really scared them. And the Speaker was unable to gavel them down. HCR 9 was a state sovereignty resolution that I introduced. It was funny because I had trouble getting people to sign on at the time. I mean, I put it out on the HRA listserv, anybody want to sign on? Got a few takers, but you know, I think I had three co-sponsors of the five I could have. And got there that February, the day of the hearing, and people were in the hall saying, why didn't I know about this? Why didn't I know about this? Bill was one of them. I said, I don't know why you didn't know about it. You know, I put it out there. And at that point, there were, I think, 12 other states with sovereignty resolutions of some form in the work, something like that. And two weeks later, we had the executive session. And the word was that all the Democrats were supporting it. It was a sovereignty resolution based on Jeffersonian principles. That was an accidental. And factual, for that matter. So they were all going to support it, and Terry Norelli took them in hand and said, no, this is Republican. It's against President Obama. That was what people thought. Now, when I came up with the idea, he had not yet been nominated, so it had nothing to do with him. It came out of one of the plays for the National Heritage Center for Constitutional Studies. I was on state sovereignty, and I was playing Madison, and Diane Gilbert said, why don't you read the Kentucky resolutions? I read it and said, wow! And we were sitting there, Al was going to make the motion of ought to pass, which is state and federal. And as Al kind of opened his mouth to say something, and Chris Roberts was going to vote against the Democrats because he felt they had been speaking, they had collaborated online in a non-public manner. And she is the firefighter who was on state and federal. I can't remember his name anymore. Hmm? No. He was vice chair at the time. Anyway, he suddenly makes a motion of inexpedient to legislate. Floored everybody. Apparently, I had my back. Terry Norelli peeked in the door to make sure things went the way she wanted them to. And it failed, whatever the number was, with all the Republicans and Chris Roberts voting in favor. And in March, there was a rally for HCR 9 on the ground, you know, on the steps of the State House. We gathered like 300 people on a. It was like 10 degrees out. There were 300 people out there protesting in favor of HCR 9. And as I'm speaking to the crowd, the word came down from on high that we could have the vote early in the day or late, or we could have the vote early in the day, or we could have it postponed to another week. So I asked the crowd, and they chose to do it that day. Probably the wrong thing to do. I'll tell you why. But so go up, and we have the vote, and of course Democrats are in power, and it fails. And in the gallery, the gallery was packed, better than Right to Work. The gallery was packed, and when the vote failed, there was just this huge uproar. And there were a lot of people up there carrying openly. And then a group who was not carrying, standing in the corner, nobody knew who the heck they were, starts reciting part one, article 10, very forcefully, out loud. Well, I get out there, Terry's gaveling. Nothing happens. So I go and stand down in the aisle, and I start going like this, and the crowd in the gallery quiets. and the presence of firearms and the people reciting Article 10 in the gallery truly scared the Democrats. I mean, there were people there going, and so they then moved to make firearms illegal. So one of our first moves in 2012 was to make them legal again. Or to take away the prohibition. We weren't making them legal. They were lawful anyway. But anyway, that was as an instance where Terry Norelli would have been within right to hold the gallery in contempt. And there's another interesting thing, judiciary. Our Constitution gives the House the power to hold people in jail indefinitely for contempt of the House. The Senate, governor, and executive council can only hold people in jail for 10 days. The judiciary has no constitutional authority to hold people in contempt or to jail them for contempt. We actually prescribe the terms for which they can hold people in contempt. They have since claimed, as part of judicial power, an inherent power to hold in contempt. As they had under the English system. Now, if we prescribe in our Constitution an unlimited power, we just have the right power to jail people in the House. The Senate and governor and council have the power to jail people for 10 days. And no constitutional authority is given to the judiciary as they had under the English system. That means it was a positive and intentional deprivation, leaving it subject to the legislature. What does the judicial claim of inherent authority amount to? Okay, we have natural and inherent rights. What does an inherent power to hold people in contempt amount to? Connect the dots, come on.
Tyranny?
Divine right.
Yeah. Same thing.
That's what they are claiming, is divine power. Contemplate that. That's what they're pushing. Think of how they've behaved for the past 60 years, accreting more, to use Senator Rubens' word, accreting more and more power to themselves. Actually, no, not for the last 40 years. Since 1819, accreting more and more power to themselves. They who were supposed to have the least power, because they have plenary power within their jurisdiction. And the legislature just sits by and says, oh, they're smart. I want you, after the debacle of the Brock and Thayer impeachment, and that was in the term just before I arrived, brought by my mentor, Paul Mirsky. In my first term, 2001-2002, in 2001, the legislature, and you've all heard about the Judicial Conduct Committee and how ineffectual they are, right? Both in terms of in true power and in their desire to hold anybody accountable. Anyway. Right. That would be the Judicial Misconduct Committee. The legislature created its own Judicial Conduct Committee. And that was challenged in court, I presume by some lawyer. I have no idea who brought the case. That was challenged in court. And the Supreme Court came back and said the Legislative Judicial Conduct Committee was unconstitutional. And we said, oh, they must be right. Two years earlier, they came out with Claremont II. We said, oh, they must be right.
But clearly, in that situation, Claremont, clearly, without any legal background at all, that judge, that particular judge, was over 70 years old.
What constitution did they use to justify their decision?
That I don't.
Kentucky. Beautiful judicial trick. Did it in 1857, too. The power of the idea that you don't have a right to trial by jury for a violation level offense originates because it's a strange event in its own right. Okay. Violation offenses are, by their nature, civil. How does the government mount a civil case against an individual? Is there any provision for that in the Constitution? Okay. The denial of a jury trial in violation offenses, civil cases, of the state against an individual is denied denied pursuant to Part 1, Article 20, which is jury trial between two or more individuals. In 1857, there was a civil case, and what I did was, you know, you're told, you know, when did we lose this right? And it went back to a 1984 case. And then you followed the next case before that. You look through the reference cases, and I've been very fortunate to just take the right stab in the dark to go to the next preceding case and follow it back to 1857. And there's a civil case. And the judges, in denying a right to trial by jury, they take out their special reading glasses. They must be funny colored. An odd optic. And they look at Article 20, and Article 20 says, in all controversies concerning property, in all suits between two or more persons, except those in which another practice is and has been customary. Okay? So, unless at the time the Constitution was written, 1784, there was another practice for handling a particular type of civil case, such as involuntary committal. There was a different process. You have a right to trial by jury. Well, that had been cited, maybe I think this is an 1865 case. In 1858, they go back and they reference another case, and they just kind of make a glancing blow at it. in which they rightly showed that you did have a right to trial by jury. And then 1865, they had this one, and, well, you don't have a right to trial by jury, and they cite an 1862 Minnesota case referencing its constitution, and they say, and it is everywhere construed that you have a right to trial by jury. You only have a right to trial by jury if that was the case when the Constitution was written. Well, by golly, that's what the Minnesota Constitution says. And I reversed that. The Minnesota case was older than the New Hampshire case in which they found the right to trial by jury. So they say, long ago in this case 3 years ago, you had the right to trial by jury. But in this case from Minnesota, they found that they didn't because their constitution says that you don't have a right to trial by jury. And from then on, in New Hampshire, you only had a right to trial by jury in a case if that was the practice when the Constitution was written. And so, if you have a new type of civil case, like a violation, you don't have a right to trial by jury. And we believed them. Yes, it's getting, well, it is 8:30. So I suppose we really ought to break up. And we haven't even touched Article 6 yet. One of the grossest rewriting of an article in human history. But, you know, this, why do we let them get away with it? We've been letting get away with it for almost 200 years, 197 years. Because we don't read the Constitution. Because people don't read the Constitution. And elect those of us who know what to do. See you in 2 weeks? Yeah, and actually I was forced to a slight amendment.